Thank you. studio here at Soul Pancake Studios. My name is Barb Skoog, and I'm an artist here in Southern California, and I've been practicing, specializing in the a Turkish form of marbling called Ebru, E-B-R-U, which is what you've just been seeing me doing for the past, 30, 40 minutes or so. I lose track of time when I'm marbling in the tank. So the Turkish form of marbling is I float paints on a thickened bath, and then I create designs and patterns using special tools, which you may have seen today. And then I transfer the image onto paper or fabric or wood or anything that's kind of porous. And I do that by simply placing it right onto the surface of the bath. So, as I mentioned, my bath is thickened, and it's thickened with carrageenan, which is a seaweed extract. It's food grade. You find it in things like ice cream and yogurt and toothpaste. So it gives things viscosity without solidifying them the way, say, gelatin makes Jell-O solid. And it's really important to have my bath have that viscosity or that thickness in it, because that holds my paints up. And then the paints that I'm using are acrylic paints, but you can also, today I'm using acrylic paints, but you can also use gouache or watercolor or even oil paints as well. And we need to make sure that our paints are thin enough to spread across the surface of that thickened bath. So I thin these down with a little bit of water. And then it's just a matter of maintaining surface tension throughout the marbling process. So you'll notice that as I throw colors, they don't mix with one another, they don't amalgamate. And what's happening here is each color is retaining its individuality in the tank, and they're just bumping up against each other like bumper cars. And so that's how we get those kind of round stone-like drops of paint on the surface of the bath. And then my job is to manipulate those into certain patterns by using different strokes and different tools. So marbling dates back to the 15th century. This particular Ebru marbling dates back to the 15th century, where an area that was then Turkey, Persia, India. And prior to that, they learned about marbling from the Japanese. And the Japanese practice what is called suminagashi. And that is where they float inks on a plain water bath. So the difference between suminagashi and Ebru is one bath is thickened and the other bath isn't. And one bath uses acrylic paints or paints, and the other uses inks instead. And with suminagashi, you can't, because there's no viscosity in the tank, you can't create those combed patterns. So with suminagashi, the inks just kind of float around, and you don't get concentric circles or anything like that. And so the thickened bath allows us to create those traditional patterns. And most people are familiar with those patterns in old books. If you open up an old book, the end sleeves are often decorated with beautiful marbled papers. And those were done by mostly Turkish marblers. And for years and years and years, marbling, either suminagashi or Ebru, was practiced exclusively by individuals. In suminagashi, it was practiced by royalty, and only royalty could do it. And then when it made its way to Turkey, it was people's livelihood. It was their trade. And so there was someone that knew how to make the bath, but then that person didn't know how to make the paints. There was someone else that knew how to make the paints, but someone else who didn't know how to make the patterns. So for years and years and years, it was a very mysterious art form. Not many people knew how to do it. A lot of the formulas for mixing paints, for pattern work, were kept secret. And it wasn't until about the 1700s when someone in Germany decided to write all this information down. Was like, you know, this is a really great art form. We should probably capture some of this detail. And then marbling didn't really make a resurgence didn't hit the United States big time until about the 1980s. And I learned about marbling 10 years ago on a trip with girlfriends. There was a special exhibit of marbling that wasn't just the bookends, but they were actually kind of artwork on the wall. And I saw a demonstration by one of those amazing marblers from the 80s. And I ended up taking a class from him, and I've been marbling every day ever since. It's just one of those art forms that just completely captivates me, because every single time it's different. I can never repeat the same pattern over and over again, at least in the sense that the colors are going to be different. I can throw the same colors, but the order in which they are laid down makes a difference. The depth of the bath is going to change. The temperature that I've been working in today has changed, and so the way my paints flow, it changes. So every single piece is an individual piece of work. It's truly the definition of unique. So my paper here is, I applied a mordant to it, a binding agent, so I just spray that on there. Everything that you marble has to have a mordant, has to have a binding agent on there. So I spray it on there, I let it dry, and then I'm just going to lay this across the surface of the bath. All I'm interested in is all the paint that's sitting on the surface of the bath. Everything that's fallen to the bottom, sometimes paints get heavy and they fall to the bottom, that's not going to get picked up by my paper. Only what is just on the very surface of the bath. And you only get one shot to do this, so you have to learn how to put your paper down confidently in one smooth motion across the surface of the bath. And then once the second my paper hits the surface of the bath, that image is immediately transferred and permanently affixed. So I can move this around and it's not going to change what's underneath this pattern. I can leave it on there for 3 days, I can leave it on there for 3 seconds, it doesn't matter. And then we just pull it off. And voila. So what I have here the tools that you saw me use was, we have rakes and combs in marbling. The difference between a rake and a comb is really kind of silly in my opinion, but rakes, their teeth are spaced at least an inch apart, and combs are less than an inch. So this is a quarter inch comb, this is a 1 inch comb, and then this is called a bouquet comb. And we have this fancy thing called a stylus here, which is a bamboo skewer. And then we have whisks. There are two ways to get paint onto the surface of the bath. One is with a whisk and one is with eyedroppers. And I switch back and forth between those two depending on the look that I want. So this is what a whisk looks like. And it's just like a broom whisk, like at the end of your broom. That's exactly what it is. And in Turkey, it would be horsehair and rosewood as the stem. So that's one way to get the paint on there. And another way is with an eyedropper. And you can kind of see the different effects. With an eyedropper, when I put this paint on there, it's called boulders. And when I use a whisk, it's called stones. So you can kind of see how the difference, depending on the look that I want, I'll figure out which way I want to start getting paint onto the surface of my bath. So the longer a pattern sits on the surface of the bath, the more it starts to disintegrate. So I tried as much as possible to slow down during this process, but usually I work quite quickly because I don't want my paints to be drying out on the surface of my bath. And then I just create patterns using, you know, different strokes and different size tools, and or I just, as I like to tell my students, go rogue in the tank and just have fun. It is really quite easy to learn how to do this. There's technical skills. You have to learn how to make the bath and make the mordant and mix the paints up correctly. But once you get those things down, I mean, from your very first piece, you can't really go wrong. It just, you're off and running, and it's your own world, and you have to focus in on the moment, on the now, because as I said, you have to work rather quickly in the bath to keep things moving along. So it really focuses you to stay present. And then you have a wonderful, you develop a relationship with the weather and the things that are going on around here. So I'm constantly looking at humidity levels and winds and temperatures and adjusting my bath and my paints accordingly. Do one last color on here. It's just so satisfying sometimes. And then you did see me also do a little technique. This is called a Spanish marble. So rather than laying down the paper in one smooth motion, I'm going to jiggle the paper a little bit when I lay it down, and then that will create a little bit of an undulating look. So there's so many ways to manipulate your bath and your paints and what you're doing, and it can be a complete and total reflection of your mood. It's easy to experiment because there's just no harm, no foul. Every single piece that comes off the bath is incredibly satisfying. There you go. So. I hope you enjoyed the show today. I hope it gave you a few moments to breathe deep and sink into the magic of marbling. So thanks so much for joining us.